Can you imagine if we were taught in school about the invisible, ethereal power that lives within you from the time you were learning to read and write? Can you imagine if it was just part of the curriculum from the day you stepped into the classroom around 4 or 5 years old to meditate and how to quiet your mind and learn how to visualize successful outcomes for a test coming up later that day or for success in everything and anything you set your mind to? Can you imagine if your health class also included the spirit, not just the mind and the body, for all over health, the true Holy Trinity? You see, sometimes I feel like I'm called to this work to make up for lost time. I'm finding every way I can to speak, evoke a memory, and touch into the hearts of every searching soul about their own direct connection with this greater power, this greater love we call God. Spirit, source, spirit, whatever word makes you feel that direct connection with the aha, that wow feeling of something greater. So I know innately from my source of my being that we would have such a happier, kinder, more tolerant society if this is where it started, right? So that's really my goal. Like if we were given that, and I was given that in a great deal. I was homeschooled for many of my years as a child, and then I did go to middle school at Waldorf. But all of it was still missing a mark in the way that I was raised, because it was still teaching us about all of the seers that preceded us, and it was still, you know, Michaelmas and these big visions of a picture, and it was very fairy tale and it was very oriented, but it was still not taught to us how would we actually integrate this power. We would meditate, but we weren't sure how to really do that and what were we doing, and what we were probably doing is really kind of sitting there napping. We're not in a state of understanding the universalness, the oneness, the power in that quiet mind. So sometimes I contemplate, you know, and why, you know, I contemplate why Sunday school and youth department is so important for our kids, because they are getting that. They are meditating every week. They are walking in nature and they're listening to their intuition and are being guided here to be taught that they can apply this at school. They can apply this in a friendship that may not be friendly, right? All those good things. E.W. Tozer says it this way: what comes into your minds when we think about God is the most important thing about us. What comes into our minds when we think about God is the most important thing about us. And again, I'll fill in whatever word makes you feel connected, because the word God can be a trigger for people with a traditional Christian upbringing that didn't feel a flow or a sense of intuition with that relationship. So does it bring up memories of your childhood picture of church? Does it bring up memories of direct experiences with the Creator in a dream or through a synchronicity that was so profound and overwhelming? It just could not have been a coincidence, like the divine meeting of your significant other, or the bond you have with your child that is beyond this lifetime. It's a knowing. It's like the child is handed to you and you know that child in a different way than just meeting them for the first time. You fill in the blank here. Let's scan our memory of when you've had that life moment where something stopped you and said, that came from something bigger. That came from something greater, much more than a coincidence. Because the more we recognize how often that's shown up in our lives, the more we will look through a lens that sees and looks for the times that that's showing up, and it's showing up all the time. Right? It becomes a reference. It's like we open up because we're looking through the eyes that expects. The Spirit is touching in on everything, any discord, any issue we're facing right now. The universe is just waiting for our attention to swoop in and be in a state of allowance for that healing. For me, when I think about what comes to mind for me with God, it's a sound of my name being called out through the tones of harmonics being repeated over and over. Syntysche, Syntysche, Syntysche. And it was many voices. It wasn't just one. It was actually the sound of almost a harmony of people's voices saying it. And the voices were familiar. Not from this lifetime, but there was a homeness to it. When I experienced my name being called out, I was sitting up in my bed. And when I turned around, I saw my physical self still laying down sleeping. I wasn't scared. It felt so natural to be lifted out of the body and so fully alive in my light body. When I looked down the hallway of my bedroom in this moment, there was a tunnel of light that was drawing me towards it. The sound of my name, while the many voices were saying and singing it, were filled with a message, but there was no message but my name. But the message was, if I can interpret it all, was there was a plan for me. And it wasn't a plan for me. There was a plan for everyone. And I just knew it in that moment. There's a plan for me. And that there was much planning for my arrival for this go-around in this lifetime, too. So not only was there a plan for everyone, but there's also planning for the arrival of my experience here. The sense of separateness I had felt in my earthly body and as an individual soul was not even tangible at all. I felt a part of everything, and everything was a part of me. The experience happened during some of the darkest days of my life, and it changed my life right there and then. I don't remember re-entering my body. I just woke up, and I laid there so full of love. And I cried, and I cried, and I cried, and I cried, and I cried. And all I kept saying to myself is, my life will never be the same. My life will never be the same. It was, oh my gosh, right? It also meant a lot of things, because the life that I had built up until then was built from insecurity and a lack of self-love. And I had a lot of dismantling I needed to do now. So, I've always wanted to try to find the wording of what that experience, that kind of love felt like. And I don't know if it lasted for 2 hours. I don't know if that was 1 minute. You know, Edgar Cayce says that time and spirit is so much vaster. What we're experiencing here in 2 seconds could be 10 years on the other side. It's like, why, when we lose a loved one and they pass over, for them it's like they blink their eye and then we're back together, right? So time is an interesting thing, but I found these words right after I wrote this part and was remembering what God, you know, the memory of God was for me. And Paul Freeney puts it so beautifully like this. You see what you choose to see, because all perception is a choice. And when you cease to impose your meanings on what you see, your spiritual eyes will open and you will see a world free of judgment and shining in its endless beauty. The shackles of earth will fall away, and you will be free to ascend to your place amongst the brightest stars. There you will look down on earth as I do now, and you will say with compassion, there I walked too, when I was afraid, and learned to walk through all my fears. It is a holy place, a place where every enemy became a friend, and every friend a brother and a teacher. It is a holy land where the dream of death and separation came to an end. I don't think I could have written that better, so that's what's so nice about all these beautiful spiritual beings that precede us, and actually Paul Freeney still walks amongst us. He is his book, Love Without Conditions, I think it is probably the greatest spiritual book ever written. So if you're needing something to hold you, love you, blow wind into your dreams and heal stuff, we have that book in the office. He goes on from there and he says this. He writes from the perspective that Christ consciousness is talking to us, right? So it is from the Christ point of view, but it's that higher consciousness that's within us, but it still has a separation, like some guy's talking to us. We have to kind of take that out of the wording. I feel privileged to have taken the journey and happy to be home at last. Then you will know that you did not have to take the journey to understand all this. You could have stayed home, which is not come into this earthly body, without any taint on your innocence. But had you not taken the journey, you would have not known your innocence as I know it, and as our father and our mother knows it. An angel who has not fallen from grace can never be a co-creator with God, for he or she is not capable of conscious creation. To create consciously, you must understand your creation. That's very important right there. That's my favorite. To create consciously, you must understand your creation. And we very rarely understand our creation until we come up against it, where we're feeling extremely blocked or extremely in fear or in a state of loss or a state of grief. And we don't know which direction to go. We don't know what to do, and we are in that overwhelm. And in those moments, we remember, oh, I'm trying to do this. I'm trying to do this, like my will be done. But if I just let go and I surrender into this thing that's pushing up against me, that feels like it's taken all of my joy, all my good, all my health, all my away from me, and just start to speak, thy will be done. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, creating this heaven really in the midst of our experience. This quote is from Rumi, but it's a big chapter in the book we're studying in our women's book group. And it says, the breeze at dawn has secrets to tell you. Don't go back to sleep. It goes on to say, you must ask for what you really want. Don't go back to sleep. People are going back and forth across the door sill where the two worlds touch. The door is round and open. Don't go back to sleep. Think about that. The door is round and open. So when we get this feeling like we're oppressed and we're up against something that can't move, it's actually a door that's round and open. The universe, the spirit, all of it is in the midst. It's a swirling. You know, you see the twirling dervas. That's their whole spiritual thing. It's this round process. It's always moving. This energy is always moving. It's not just forward moving. So when it feels stuck here, we got to move. We got to change our direction. We got to open our mind. We got to open our eyes. Elizabeth Lesser goes on to say this in her book, I've tried both ways. I have gone back to sleep in order to resist the forces of change. And I have stayed awake and been broken open. Both ways are difficult, but one way brings with it the gift of a lifetime. If we can stay awake when our lives are changing, secrets will be revealed to us. Secrets about ourselves, about the nature of life, and about the eternal source of happiness and peace that is always available, always renewable, already within us. But we have to grow from the inside out. You have to grow from the inside out. So we look to teachers and we look to other people to tell us the how-to. We think that somehow they got some sort of a breakdown of how life works. How do we do this victoriously, and how we do it with joy and peace in our hearts? And the truth is it's discovered from here. It's sitting in that silence. It's sitting with those whispers that you get in contemplating and meditating on them until they expand and they expand and they lead you. And the more that it wakens you up, you start to remember your potential, this power that is you, that you were born with. But the world shuts it down and it closes us out, and we start to forget who we truly are, which is the divine expression of God. We are the perfect children of God. And we express that as we learn who and remember who we truly are. So I'm going to be sharing a video right now that I can't show on live stream. If you don't watch the show, the golden buzzer means she went right to the finale. She doesn't even have to do all the rest of the auditioning and everything else. So she's so much closer to a deal. And I'm sure if you're a spiritual seeking person that you recognize the spiritual soul in that being. That was such an authentic, honest person. She just flowed. And she wasn't broken from all she went through. She was just raw and real and unapologetically real. Just even when he says at the end, you know, so you didn't ever play out that, you didn't actually get your music out there. She could have said, well, I've sung all my life and I took lessons. You know how we do this defending? She didn't. She goes, no. This is the first time putting out there. Well, you didn't get a record deal if you weren't singing your entire life. You know, most people would be defending. You know, you're there, but she didn't. There was just something about the soul of this human being of just is such a beautiful visual of being broken open. So last week, we went through some quantum physics tools, and I'm going to revisit those. And I'm going to use Lily for a little bit of an example for us to apply them a little bit more this week. So the first quantum tool, and we're going to go on beyond these ones, was turn up your frequency. So my feelings create a frequency. The higher the frequency, the higher my motivation. The faster and the easier my dreams will flow to me. So heightening the frequency. So how do we do that? That's meditation, that's visualization, that's seeing yourself as the powerful being you know that you are, but we somehow keep coming up short. We got to get to that higher frequency. So Lily didn't go back to sleep after losing her music contract to tend to the needs of her dying mother. She said, I think it was meant to be because I got to spend more time with her. She wasn't in fear of losing that contract, and she was even probably willing to lose all of it because of that loving relationship with her mom. This is someone who has faced that threshold where her choice was to not return to her dreams due to a devastating loss, but by her stepping in once again with a new perspective of the meaning of the song she wrote, she turned up her frequency. It's at a different level because she said it's a different perspective she has on a song she wrote before than she did originally. And that knowledge is needed when you're working in a musical world. You're going to be coming up a lot of things. You have to know all the perspectives of life to be able to really share this work. And I think she's going to be amazing. And she brushed herself off and showed up to America's Got Talent. You'll see, I had to cut the ending, but she's back. Nobody's backstage waiting for her. She's by herself there. She goes back, she's talking to the guy backstage, and there's no one there to give her a hug or anything. I mean, it's just amazing. I don't see that in myself that I could have ever done that. Like, that's what I think blows my mind. Like, there's no way I'd stand behind that stage with those many people and then not have somebody rooting for us, for me. The next one was set a powerful intention to align with love or above. Set a powerful intention to align with love or above. Create an awareness of where you are and a relationship with where your dreams are. And if you start to feel sad or angry or annoyed, that's okay. Feel it. Be with it. Honor it. Because in the honoring are the feelings. We can release them to love. So we can't avoid how we feel about stuff. We can grieve things that have fallen away from us. It's important because when we deny actually stuff that's actually underneath the surface within us, we can't get to the dream. It's got a life of its own. It's got its own vibrational pull that's pulling more of this hurt and fear and shame that we're carrying in us. So we got to face those feelings. It's okay to be disappointed. It's okay to be lost. But then when you realize that you've faced it, then you go out there and you face that dream again. See, Lily here said her mom would have never wanted her to give up her dreams. That faith, by setting a powerful intention to align with that love she had with her mom, she wasn't going to give up with her dreams. It took her beyond the shadow that death can lead. She went through that death process, and she could have gone with her mom. A lot of people do. The grief of that would have stopped her. And this is a youth industry. 27 is actually kind of old. It's a youth industry, so she really didn't have time to just now sit and wallow. It was, am I going to do this? My mom wants me to still do this, right? And that brought her above her own fears of stepping back into the arena of her music, which is her God-given gift. This lifetime, right? The quantum tool number three, shift your energy to what lights you up. Shift your energy to what lights you up. You know, life, when you've got spouses and you've got friends and you've got children and you've got so many dynamics of people, there's a lot of things that can distract us that we're trying to help somebody get through this divorce, and we're trying to help somebody that's going through this, and it can keep us so we're so busied for us not to be focused on our life, on our energy, and remembering what lights us up. We're here to play. It's not just supposed to be painful. We're supposed to achieve our dreams. It's good to help others. I'm not saying don't give up on helping each other, but if it's all you're doing, then you're probably doing that to distract yourself from you and the dreams that you have are letting settle and fall to the wayside. For what? Money? For what? You know, like, are we just doing and staying busy and we think someday it's all going to slow down and then I'm going to go after my dreams? It's never going to happen then. Shift your energy to what lights you up. Give at least 60% of your energy to that and then help beyond that. And if you don't have the time, you got to fill your glass to serve. Fill your glass so that you're going after your dreams, because that is Christ consciousness and that has a radiating effect on other people. And when you're around people, when you're lit up, it lights them up. It's like praying for them because you're praying for yourself. We take care of each other by vibrational energy. So you're actually hurting the energy of the world when you're not aligning with your dreams still. Quantum tool number four. Surround yourself with energy that elevates you. People and energy that elevates you. Observe your environment. Notice how you are walking through life. Are you surrounding yourself with people who are making you stretch, helping you leap, helping you to fly, to be the best version of yourself? And even if you don't have those people surrounding you, you can be that for yourself. If you can see yourself rightly. If you are, you are around high vibrational people. Stay around them. Let them energize you, encourage you, and keep you running. Are you around people who drain the energy out of you, that leave you feeling anxious, tired, and weighted down? I mean, this should be as simple as it could be. But if you look at your lives, how many people have people in their lives that are draining them right now? Yeah, that's a disappointing number. Right? But we do because, well, they don't have anybody else. You know, they make me feel important because I am there when they are drooling all of their negativity all over my being and... You know, just make sure you don't do too much of it. Paul Farini says it this way. So besides your goodness, which is your birthright, what else is there? There could be the doubt that you are not good. There is fear. Your life is made up of goodness, assaulted by doubt and fear. How many times during the course of a day do doubt and fear challenge your perception of your goodness? How many times do they challenge your perception of your brother's and your sister's goodness? Conflict is erased from the mind that recognizes its own goodness. This is really important right here. Conflict is erased from the mind that recognizes its own goodness. And having recognized its own goodness, it cannot maintain it except by extending it to others. If you see another as bad, you have allowed doubt and fear back into your mind. And I'm not saying that the negative energy people are bad, but just make sure you keep a check-in on how much of that energy you're allowing into your system. How strong do you think your system is until that eventually afflicts you with something? Because we are energy. We talked about that we are 100% energy. And if we're letting this lower nature energy be into our presence all the time, we will end up sick. Or we will end up with mental apparitions. We will end up in divorces. We will end up because we will lose our Christ consciousness. That is us as us in expression for this world to be the majesty that Jesus said we would be. We would work the same miracles and more. So let's own it. We have to take to task what's in our living situation. Who's around us? What are we listening to? Who's giving us feedback that we're believing? Because the only feedback you should be listening to is here. This one tells you the truth. You know how you know? Because when you're doing something against your highest good, you feel horrible. When you're doing something out of alignment of your soul's being as creation in this world, you will feel pinched off from life. You will feel lonely. You will feel things like depression. You will feel low energy. You'll be attracted to eating at McDonald's. When you're high vibration, you want to run. You want to get in nature. You want to play in rivers. You want to be with your kids. You want to express. You want to get away from toxic chemicals and just nurture this vehicle that God gave us. It's such a gift. This life is such a gift. And Lily showed us in a great example. She said she put her butterfly outfit on that day. She stepped out on that stage. She cast away her own doubt and fear and told herself she wouldn't cry. But because of her vulnerability, of the beauty of the life she lived, even through the challenges, she could persevere, and those judges could feel her. That vulnerability was so important. That vulnerability, you could feel her soul. She tried to hold it back. She tried, and the universe said, it's okay. You're in a safe space. Look at all these young people that are going to listen to you today. Only when you reject the bad and accept the good will you cast fear out of your heart. Not one of God's children can be bad. At worst, he or she is hurt. At worst, he or she attacks others and blames them for his or her pain. But he or she is not bad. Only one who is in fear judges another. Are you beyond the grip of fear? If not, then recognize your fear and be with it. Avoiding the fear just builds it. It just turns into the ghost underneath your bed that you're just avoiding all the time. When we face and turn back and face our fear and be with it, it is one of the greatest teachers. You will find joy to the contrast to the level of the fear over here will have that much more light. That contrast is huge. And you'll never go to the depth of the fear after you finally visit that deepest cut, that deepest shame, that deepest something that made you feel less than perfect. Less than a perfect child of God. Quantum tool number 5. Stand strong for what is not an option for you. Start saying to the universe, what is not an option? It's kind of like the prayer of denials. You're denying that you're going to allow this in your life. Catherine Ponder explains it very well, but it's your spouse is cheating on you or something like this, and some people will just accept it and go yell at the girl or guy or whatever the affair is going on with. But in your prayers, you're going, I literally deny that this will happen in my life. I will not accept this. Like, we are part of this current and this energy, and there are some things that you know this is your soulmate, and you're saying, hell no. I will deny that this is going to take my life and take that abundance from me. And then, thank you, God, thank you, God, thank you, God, thank you, God. Right? And the universe is like, oh, okay, heard you loud and clear. We'll take that girl out of the way, or whatever it is. Or stand strong for what is not an option for you. Right? So Lily in the situation, here I feel like we watched something happen. We watched something miraculous. And it's when Heidi Klum said, I saw a light around you. Remember? I saw a light around you, and I don't know what it is. I just love you. Who was that? Who was Heidi Klum in that moment? That was Lily's mom. Lily's mom saying, thank you for dropping everything and spending my last minutes on earth. You thought you've lost all of it. And I'm right here going, no, you're going to get it all back and you're going to have it abundantly Because you did the honorable thing. You chose love. You didn't choose fear. You didn't choose control and not think that God was taking your good from you in this moment. And everything you worked for was being taken away with your mom's cancer. No! She left it all and she did what was being asked as a devoted servant of God, as a daughter of a mother. And it all came back to her abundantly. Is there anything else I have to say about this? Let's take an offering for unity now. Love you guys.
We've had the opportunity to be exposed to the direct beauty of spirit sharing with us here in unity. Let me say this as well. You know, when we have entertainers come up here, we have different entertainers all the time. It's really wonderful to be in Boulder and have so many talented people. But there is something that we saw here on this film, something that transcends just talent. It is connection. It means that somebody is so in alignment with spirit that you sense it as well. Just like the lady jumped up and said, I don't know, but I just feel love for you. Well, I can tell you that the last time Aletheia Rising did a concert here, we filled the fellowship hall, and everybody in that fellowship hall was so filled with the love that comes through these talented people. You don't want to miss this concert. And so we'll take an offering for unity now, but when we're done doing that, go and pick up a ticket for what will be the most beautiful, moving night of your life to Aletheia Rising. So bring to mind that financial gift you'd like to make to Unity of Boulder, and let's share it with this offering prayer. Divine love through me blesses and multiplies all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive. Because I give. So it is.
It's a bit of a tough act to follow, and it's really hard to sing when you're crying. Thank you. And we chose the song Jewel. Sure, everyone has heard of Jewel before, and she was very popular maybe, 20 years ago or so, but this song just still is relevant timelessly. And
especially relevant after Syntysche's amazing talk. So,
and what I'm up to personally in my life right now. So, mm-hmm. Yeah, we hope you'll sing with us on the chorus as we come around to it.
Don't worry, Mother, it'll be all right. And don't worry, Sister, say your prayers and sleep tight. And it'll be fine, Lover of mine, it'll be just fine. And lend your voices only to sounds of freedom. No longer lend your strength to that which you wish to be free from. Fill your lives with love and bravery, and you shall lead life uncommon.
Thank you so much. So the tickets are available in the bookstore right now for $12 only. We have fellowship right after the service in this room. I've got two spots left for the Broken Open book group that I'm holding on Tuesdays, and we'll have a gathering with me after the service at quarter till in the back of the sanctuary just to discuss the sermon or anything that stood out or any questions that you have. Let's all rise. Oh, we have prayer partners available to you if you're facing a challenge. If you just stay seated, the women with the white cloaks will come and find you, and they'll pray with you in the sanctuary. So please rise, and let's close the closing song.
I release and I let go. I let the Spirit run my life, and my heart is open wide. Yes, I'm only human pride. No more struggle, no more strife. In my faith I see the light. I am free in the Spirit. Yes, I'm only here for God. I release
it announced? The equinox is this Thursday, led by Norma. At what time?
7 p.m.
At 7 p.m. in the Fellowship Hall.
Right.
Equinox ceremony, 7 o'clock thank you.